So here to tell us her story, Peace Corps Portland, please welcome the one, the only, the famous, the fabulous, Wendy Allegaert!
I was told to bring this on stage by Kathleen. She said it's very New York. So, when people ask me, whenever anybody asks me what made me move to Portland from New York, I inevitably deflect the conversation and I make a joke, because I'm just so freaked out that I did it. And I can't quite believe that I did it and how I did it and when I did it. So I just say, I have no idea. Why don't you tell me? Or it picked me, or I don't fucking know. But I'm here. But that's actually not quite accurate. I know very much why I came here. And it's actually not a joke at all. And it's actually very much worth having a conversation about it, because I think any time someone learns how to listen to that voice inside themselves that says, do something, get out of your comfort zone, so change, stop sleeping, wake up, scare yourself. If you're that lonely and you're that lost, then do something. It's worth sharing. So I had that experience a couple of years ago. It was May in 2012, and I had a series of episodes, and they say things come in threes. Well, I had a package of four that really made me wonder what my life was about. I ran into a wall with my world, a brick wall, that made me really only want to move to another planet. I really thought the only thing that could help revitalize that space in life where you say, oh, life is special, right? Like, and my life is special, my life is unique. I'm supposed to notice that. Because as we know from tonight's storytelling, it doesn't last. So. It's not forever. So we got to move along. And I wanted to know what that was like for me. And I thought, what the only thing that'll do that, the only thing that can really put me in a moment right now is if I got to move to the moon. I mean, think about it, right? Like, if you got out of a spaceship and you got to put your foot on the moon, you're gonna be in the moment. You're not gonna miss that moment. You will remember it for the rest of your life. You're on the moon. So in May of 2012, I had a series of episodes that were really very far away from the moon. I lost a job that I had for 5 years, and it was a no-brainer job, a time to make the donuts job, but it was my job, and it was the way I was making money, and I wasn't expecting to lose it that Friday afternoon with the amount of money that I had in the bank at the time. So that was a shock. At the same time, I was having a continuous challenging moment with my mother. It had been a challenging moment of about 25 years at that point. There was a conversation that continued to go, well, let's talk about whose life this is really anyway. And it was getting to be really upsetting. It was getting to scare me and shock us both and fill us with dismay, and it was starting to affect our relationship. And at the same time, my creativity was starting to diminish in a way that was not making me terribly happy. I've been an actor in New York for 20 years and was plugging along, pounding the pavement, and I realized those opportunities were becoming smaller and smaller, and I was becoming smaller and smaller with that realization. In fact, there was one moment where I was in a casting office. I was at a seminar in a room like this with a lot of people around, and I was doing some work, and the casting director was like, well, isn't she lovely? I mean, here is an example of an incredibly talented actor who deserves to work. It's just so unfortunate. At the same time, she doesn't see that the way she deals with her hair is keeping her from opportunities. Yeah. Should I know, you know, my kingdom for a comb? I wish I were joking. So those three things, one of those things alone would challenge a human being, but altogether I was feeling a little pummeled. But it was the fourth thing. In July 2012, it was a subway ride, which, if any New Yorkers are here, we know what subways do to us, particularly in the summer. And it was really, really hot, and it was really, really crowded. I was playing a game of sardines with about 600 other people at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I was on my way to an audition, actually getting to go understudy Edie Falco, and I was ready to chew someone's face off by the end of that subway ride. And I felt something at my foot, and I just thought it was somebody stepping on my toe, and I looked down, and there was an enormous, fat, very dirty rat scurrying through the subway like an obstacle course. And we were moving around it, and it was moving around us. And I just died. That was the moment that took me out. And that was the moment where my voice really said, you can go now. You've done your time here. Let's go find another land. Another land of opportunity awaits. And so I did just that. And no, it's not just the rat, mind you. It wasn't just the rat running around. It was also the people who seemed to have a numb-like experience of just saying, well, just move your foot or just pick up your bag. No one seemed to really be upset about that rat. It seemed to be expected and anticipated, and it really upset me. So I fled that car, determined to find a new home. The only thing was I'd been in New York my whole life, and I had no idea where to go. We forget there are other places. And weirdly enough, mystically enough, right at that time, Portland kept coming up in conversation. Over and over again, someone had just been to Portland, someone was from Portland, someone was going to Portland, and with the same enthusiasm, sense of fun, excitement, sort of refreshment if they've been back. I just got back from Portland. And I was like, what's up with Portland? I mean, I hadn't seen Portlandia. I didn't know anything. I was like, it's in the Pacific Northwest, right? And I just didn't have any, what is that? And someone said, you've never been? You've never been to Portland? No. I don't know anybody in Portland. Why would I go? And so I bought a ticket in September. And I thought, I'll buy it, I'll go. I'll take a week and see if it's for me. And I came out for a week. And as you know, in September here, it's Shangri-La. Yeah. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. People were like, oh, the rain. I'm like, what rain? It was just glorious. And it was lovely. It was beautiful out, and it was fresh, and it was green, and I had creative experiences that were fun and new, and thought, I can do this. They're gardens, and, you know, they're houses, and I saw more tattooed people and bearded ladies and nose rings. I was like, wow, it's radical, dude. It's really cool. But the thing that really happened for me here was that I discovered my moon. I had a week where every time I put my foot down on the ground, I felt very present. I felt connected to myself. I wasn't fraught with anxiety. I wasn't running into the next moment. I was simply hanging out and enjoying the time and meeting people who seemed to equally have that experience in their life, where they just were happy to be where they were, regardless of all the external things that may or may not be happening for us. And that was really magical. And so I was like, okay, I'll bite, I'm coming. and I rushed back to New York, determined just to pack and say my goodbyes and go. And as I planned my exit, I did just that. There was this little thing, a little storm, called Hurricane Sandy on its way. So it really was an opportunity for me because I was determined to go. I was determined, this is my time to move forward. I am not gonna buy a round trip ticket. I'm not subletting my apartment. I don't care that all my furniture is still gonna be here. You might have to give it away. I can't get rid of it. I'm gonna go no matter what. There's just one essential ingredient that I need, and that's a home. I can go where I don't know anybody. I can go without a job, but I can't go without a home. And I was terrified because I didn't know what the home was gonna look like, and I didn't know what to do and how to find it. So on a cold, stormy, rainy night in October of 2012, I wrote a love letter to Portland on the second floor of a Starbucks outside Port Authority. And I did this, that. It was a love letter. I simply said, Portland, I love you. I've known you for a week. It was that kind of love. I was ready. Let's not spoil it. It will just come. And B, I'd like to know you better. And I'm coming in 2 weeks. I have a cat. I have a suitcase. I have references. And I have a sense of humor. So will you have me? And I sent that letter by email to everyone I had met that week and to everyone I possibly knew had a connection to Portland. And I just sent it by email, like cyberspace in a bottle, you know, message in a bottle, by cyberspace. And it was as soon as I sent it, and I said in the subject line, if you know anyone, dot, dot, dot. And as soon as I sent it, I knew that I had shifted my perspective. I knew that I had shed my skin. I knew that I had found my home because I knew someone was going to respond to my call. And that was really highly, I forgot the word I want to use, but it was very different for me to know that I could do that in my life. And it was very different for me to take that kind of leap of faith. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. It's like if you're scared and things aren't going particularly well, I learned that's the time to really just say, okay, for fuck's sake, I'll do it. It's not working. I might as well go this way. And when I took that leap of faith, and knowing that I still didn't know what it looked like, I was enormously relieved. Now, I'm happy to say, 18 months later, that I now live in a house on the northeast side of Portland that's purple, that has chickens and rabbits and 3 cats, one is 3-legged, and a wonderful friend by the name of Devotion. Her real name is Laura, but she goes by Bhakti. And she's a weaver. She was a widow. And she, from 3,000 miles away, I discovered my friend of 3,000 years. And I think when people say, what made you move to Portland, I can honestly say it was to renew that kind of friendship, not just with another person, but with myself, to remember to listen and to trust that if something's burning so deeply in you, to try, you can take that risk and just jump, and that the world will sustain you and support you. And I'm very glad I did. Thanks.